Part two of our series on advanced methods of membrane transportation, we're going to start by looking at a process called endocytosis, which, as we can see from these two diagrams here, is used to get very large molecules that aren't able to fit through a transport protein from the outside of the cell to the inside of the cell. Now, what these large particles are depend largely on what the substrate is, but we can have examples of a full-size protein as opposed to individual amino acids, or even small microorganisms such as a bacterium or virus are examples of large substances that can be internalized into the cell through endocytosis. One alternative to this, as we see in the diagram on the right, is that we can actually have many smaller molecules, particularly small molecules that are polar, or especially small molecules that are charged, that are internalized at the same time in one go. And this is a method of getting many smaller molecules, or again, one larger particle into the cell in one specific go. As we can see in both of the diagrams here, we see that these substrates are binding to specific receptor proteins on the surface of the cell membrane. So this process is hardly indiscriminate in that even large particles or multiple smaller particles still need receptor substrate complementarity in order to bind to the specific receptor protein and send the signals that the receptor proteins send into the cell. So what exactly is happening with these signals that are sent by the receptor protein inside to the cell? Well, we can't exactly see it, but behind every receptor protein are usually other proteins that are anchored to the superstructure, the protein-based superstructure that exists inside of the cell, which is what we call the cytoskeleton. And if you have any background in the cytoskeleton, usually the cytoskeleton proteins that receive these signals are a type of protein that we call microfilaments, and these are the same type of cytoskeletal protein that are used in muscle. And the idea is that the signals transmitted by the receptor protein to the cytoskeletal microfilaments causes these microfilaments to pull the section of the cell membrane inside. So pulls the cell membrane inside of the cell. And eventually when this happens, when a large portion of the cell membrane is actually pulled inside, the parts of the cell membrane that are holding onto the specific substrate will eventually form a ring enclosing the entire substrate inside, forming what we call an endocytic vesicle, which again is simply a ball of phospholipid bilayer that encases whatever the substrate is inside of the cell like this. Now, in this case, when we're referring to this particular type of endocytosis, we are dealing with a solid form of substrate. Again, either a very large macromolecule like a full-size protein, many slightly smaller solid macromolecules, or even a small microorganism such as a bacterium like the one we see here. But because we're dealing with a solid substrate, we call this particular form of endocytosis phagocytosis, because the prefix phago in Greek literally translates to eating. In fact, there are specific types of cells whose job it is to wander around your bloodstream and eat any solid particle that it doesn't think belongs there. And these are what we call phagocytes, which are actually a type of white blood cell. Now, a similar but slightly distinctive process is the process of where the cell absorbs certain liquid particles. So for example, if the cell needs to take in a large amount of water molecules, or if the cell wants to take in a large number of aqueous particles, and again, the best example of these are ions such as Na+ or Cl-, what the cell can do is a similar process where whatever the substrate, whether it be a liquid or some sort of aqueous ion, binds two receptor proteins that are found on the cell membrane, triggers the cytoskeleton to pull parts of the cell membrane in like this, and instead of during phagocytosis, where the cell membrane actually projects outward to swallow a large particle, we find the cell membrane pulling entirely inwards like this, where the two ends of the cell membrane pinch each other off and eventually come together to form a vesicle like this. And this process is what we call pinocytosis, pino being the Greek prefix referring to drink. And again, we refer to this as cell drinking because of the liquid or aqueous components that are being pulled into the cell. Now, this process seems great. We have the ability to internalize very large particles that can't pass through the membrane through traditional diffusion, or in the case of pinocytosis, the ability to take in a great many particles all at the same time. So the logical question is, why doesn't the cell do this all the time? Well, whenever we have movement, and we have lots of movement of the cytoskeleton and the pulling of the cell membrane as a result, that means that there is lots and lots of energy in the form of ATP that is required. Obviously, your cells don't have an unlimited amount of ATP, so the ability to keep doing the process of endocytosis remains rather limited. Now, the second limitation that we have is the actual cell membrane itself. The fact that the cell membrane is not infinite, it has a limited surface area. Now, as we can see here, every time the cell does phagocytosis or pinocytosis, part of the cell membrane is actually lost in order to produce the vesicle containing the substrate that was pulled into the cell, meaning that every time we do this process, the cell membrane actually gets smaller every single time that this is used, meaning that we don't actually have the ability to keep doing this infinitely because the cell membrane will get smaller every single time. Thirdly, because this process is triggered by a specific receptor protein, not every substrate is able to trigger the process of phago or pinocytosis based on whether the fact that there may or may not be a receptor protein that matches the given substrate. And the opposite problem actually exists as well. The fact that there are many examples of pathogenic microorganisms, the best example of these are, of course, viruses that have evolved the ability to structure a specific protein to mimic a specific substrate and fool the cell into thinking that the virus is perhaps a piece of food or even a type of hormone that can trigger the process of endocytosis and therefore take advantage of this natural process in order to get into the cell. And here we see that this process is used by deadly viruses such as influenza and even the ever dreaded HIV, the virus responsible for AIDS. Now, to overcome one of these problems, the idea that the cell membrane perpetually gets smaller, we can take a look at the opposite process of endocytosis, that being exocytosis. So we can see here that the only difference is in the prefix. Exo, of course, means outside, as opposed to the opposite prefix endo, which means inside. So logically, we can assume that exocytosis is the opposite process of endocytosis, that being the process that the cell uses in order to get very large molecules, or as with endocytosis, many smaller but polar molecules outside of the cell. And as expected, this process functions like endocytosis, but in the exact opposite direction, where we have a vesicle that most likely is produced from the Golgi complex. So remember that the job of the Golgi complex is to package and export, let me just finish writing the word complex here, to package and export specific substrates into vesicles that are specifically bound for the cell membrane. Now, this vesicle will have a receptor protein on its surface, which corresponds to another receptor protein that we would this time find on the inside of the cell membrane. And when these two receptor proteins bind together, it triggers the cell membrane that the vesicle is made of to join with the cell membrane on the outside of the cell. And this is able to take place because both vesicles and the outside of the cell membrane are made up or predominantly of phospholipids, which means that the two phospholipid bilayers can actually join together, where the membrane of the vesicle and the cell membrane join together, causing the contents of the vesicle to be released outside of the cell like this. Now, these contents of whatever the vesicle was carrying, this could be an example of a hormone, or this could be in a storage cell, for example, a liver cell, where the liver cell is storing a large amount of glycogen that is then broken down to glucose, which can then be released outside of the cell in a large group like this. This concludes our series on advanced membrane proteins and advanced methods of membrane transport. So to test your knowledge of endo and exocytosis, you can take a look at this case study in which we actually look in detail about how viruses trick the cell and use the process of phagocytosis to get into the cell and exocytosis in order to export their offspring outside of the cell.